All right, so welcome everyone. So this is the first series, I think, of the year of the joint seminars of UKSPS, the UK Seminar Series in Security, and FMSEC, the UK Series on Formal Methods for Security. Once a month, we have a joint seminar. And it is our pleasure that this month we have Tom Chotia from University of Birmingham, who's going to give us what sounds like a very exciting talk. So Tom is known probably to all of you here. He's a reader in University of Birmingham in the security group. And he's been known for a lot of work, both in formal methods and in, let's call it, ethical hacking. So in passports, in privacy, in unlinkability, in payments, in practical relaying, in a number of things. And today we're going to have the pleasure to hear a different type of talk, something very novel, where we're looking at mixing machine learning and verification. So the floor is Tom's, and I hope you enjoy the talk.
Thanks a lot. Okay, so thanks for coming along to this talk. As you just heard, this talk also covers a bit of practical stuff. It's on the borderline, I think, between formal methods and more practical hacking of systems. I want to be absolutely clear that this is very much joint work. I just want to mention my co-authors. A lot of people have contributed to this work, and particularly Sam and Chris have done a huge amount of the development work, so they deserve a lot of the credit. I might say I in this talk, I really also mean we. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about is really implementational issues in systems. So I'm at heart a formal methods person, but I often come across systems where there are logical vulnerabilities which might not be in the spec, and this gives us one way to actually find those. Currently, analysis of implementations is quite ad hoc. It's often an expert hacks around with a system, and if they're lucky, they spot something. This work is a step towards bringing some of the rigor of formal methods to the analysis of implementations of systems. So first, I want to start with an example, some work I did some time ago on passports. So I looked at e-passports a while ago and did a formal analysis of how they worked. For e-passports, it's important to understand that they have all the data on the passport on the RFID chip, and this can be read remotely. Now, if you've actually used an e-passport, you'll have put it down on a scanner. An optical scanner will have read your date of birth, the date of issue, and the passport number, and that gives you the key to decrypt that information. And obviously, you don't want anyone who hasn't seen that information reading your passport. And another part of the spec said it should be impossible to match two runs of the system. It should be impossible to say, hey, this passport looks like this other passport, and say they're the same. So again, I approached this with formal methods. As a team, we built a formal model of the passport protocol. We came up with a definition of unlinkability, but you couldn't match two runs. And we tested it and found issues. So to briefly tell you about that, how that protocol worked is when someone presented their passport at a passport gate, that key information would be read off it, and a unique encryption and MAC key would be generated on the reader, which the reader would use to talk to the passport. The first message was a general wake up message. Passport picks a random nonce, sends it back to the reader. Completely untraceable here. Every passport will send a random second message, reveals no information. The reader picks its own random number and some key material and encrypts that with the unique key for the passport. And it also MACs it and sends it to the passport. The passport will check the MAC with its unique key. And if that works out, it knows the message is fine. It also knows the reader knows the key information. That reader is one it can talk to. It decrypts it, it checks its nonce to avoid replay attacks, picks its own key material, and sends that back to the reader. Reader checks for MAC, checks its nonce, and the session key is the XOR of those two values. So if you have questions, please do stop me as I go. Please type something into the chat or just unmute yourself. So if I present anything which isn't clear, please let me know. But assuming that's clear, that's the protocol, and it looks untraceable. It looks like if you were just observing the protocol, the passport would always look different. You wouldn't be able to say, that's Alice's passport. You wouldn't be able to track someone with their passport. And that's because the first message is static, second message is random, third and fourth messages are pseudo-random. Without the key, they should be meaningless. But in our analysis, we found a traceability attack against this. And the attack was to record this second message and to replay it. So I record this passport, I observe Alice, and I record this message from her protocol run. Later, a passport comes along and I want to identify, is that Alice or is it not Alice? I can replay this message and it will fail. But the question is, how does it fail? If it's not Alice, this MAC key check will fail. And I'll get an error saying bad MAC. If it is Alice, the MAC check passes, the decryption works, but the nonce check fails. So if I see a nonce error message, I know it's Alice and I can trace her. Is this example clear to people? Yeah. Sorry, I can never make Zoom calls interactive. It's awful speaking to a sea of little black boxes. I always get paranoid people aren't really there, but assuming it is correct. Now, does anyone feel a little bit cheated? Because I set up the protocol like this, and I never told you the error messages were different. I never mentioned the error messages. In fact, the spec never mentions the error messages. So I should be clear, we were absolutely clear in the paper. We didn't find this with the formal model. We found this by messing around with passports, sending them messages, seeing how they reacted. And pretty soon after seeing the message, we realized the attack was there and the formal modeling came afterwards. I think this is often the way. Sometimes the formal model really does find the vulnerability, but a lot of times messing around with the system finds the vulnerability and the formal model comes afterwards. If people are honest about that, I have no problem about that at all. But wouldn't it be nice to formalize the process of looking at the implementation, seeing how it works? The other thing is often the implementation doesn't contain the errors, or it just isn't fair at all. I think I found roughly 14 major attacks and CVEs. Only four of them are pure formal modeling, pure look at the spec, build the model finds a vulnerability. The others, vulnerabilities are often implementational issues which go against the spec, or there's no spec available. I get a system without knowing how it works. I have to do that investigation. So the question I want to answer is, how can we start to make that investigation process a little more rigorous? And just to be clear, there are excellent ways of looking at implementations already, particularly fuzzing. There's a huge amount of work on fuzzing, which is extremely good and principally aimed at crashing the implementation. If you have vulnerabilities, such as memory vulnerabilities based around a crash, fuzzing is an excellent way to do it. But what about logical vulnerabilities? What about vulnerabilities which are not based on a crash? How can we find those? So a really good answer to this question was provided by Yuri, who worked with us on this for a while, where this original work didn't include me. And Yuri had the idea of applying state machine learning. to come up with the state machine which described the behavior of the implementation. And then that could be analyzed. So he used this state machine learning technique where it's assumed you know the entire input alphabet. You know all of the possible input messages. And more or less, you're going to brute force them. You're going to find what are all possible combinations of those messages. But doing that on its own would be very time consuming, and you'd never know when you stopped. So he used a particular learning algorithm, for instance, the L star algorithm, which would add some order to this and let you know when have you learned the state machine, which represents the behavior of the system you're trying to test. So as an example, let's have a look at TLS. By far the best known protocol, I think. Can you just do a thumbs up or write in the chat if you're familiar with TLS? If I put up this protocol diagram, do these steps make sense to people? Anyone puzzled by this? Cool. So anyone want me to talk through this? I see a lot of no responses. I'm wondering how many people have just wandered off and doing something else. Okay. I'll briefly run through it. So TLS starts with a client hello message, which includes a nonce. And it's replied to by a server hello message from the server, which also includes a nonce. And the server can also request a certificate, but it has to provide its own certificate. And then the server says, that's it for me. The client sends a client a key exchange message. The client key exchange message is one of the nonce. It may provide a certificate, and then it sends a change cipher spec message. And that's the signal, now we generate the keys and send encrypted data. The server replies with a change cipher spec message, and then the server says, now I'm going to encrypt all my data, and then data is encrypted after that. So that's the formal run of the protocol. And I think quite a lot of people have modeled this in Proverif and Tamarin. This run of the protocol is very well studied. But the question is, what happens if we send the messages out of order? What happens if we send the wrong messages? What happens if we send messages with bits missing? How can we find that out? And we can apply this L star algorithm to brute force this in a clever way. So how does this work? So we approximate the state machine, and we use a Mealy machine where state transitions are labeled with the input and the output the system gives you. And I'm writing input slash output for that pair. And to begin with, the testing just tries all of the messages and sees what it gets. So it might say, for instance, just by trying all of the messages, I find the client hello is responded to by a server hello, and all the other messages just fail. So this is my first approximation of the state machine. So who thinks this is a good state machine for TLS? Well, obviously it's not. It looks nothing like that picture I told you, but for the algorithm to work it out from scratch is quite hard. So while this is a possible state machine, given what it's seen so far, it needs to dig deeper. So in fact, this algorithm sets a certain depth, often 2 or 3, and it will check the state machine, its approximations are correct to that depth. So now it takes the state machine, it says, I'm going to try adding an additional message. So from this candidate state 0, it will try all pairs of messages. And it will see that if it sends a client hello and a client hello, it gets a server hello, then a fail. And this is inconsistent with this approximate state machine. Because this approximate state machine would say client hello should be 2 server hellos. So it can tell there's another state here. This client hello message has taken it to a new state. So it can deduce there must be a state transition on the client hello. So now this becomes the approximation of the state machine of the protocol. It continues and try and repair anything which isn't a client hello, followed by a client hello, gets two fails. So now it can deduce that this arrow mustn't actually be a state change. But the only thing it knows about the state this arrow goes to is it can fail, which is consistent with this state. So it might hypothesize both of these go to the same state. This is the minimal model which fits the data so far. Continuing, it might find actually a client hello followed by a client key exchange doesn't fail. So this means there must be a new state here. And more data, another message followed by a client key exchange fails twice. Therefore, this transition is no longer compatible with the model, and we need to add a new state for that one. So we can slowly build out the minimal state machine consistent with the data. But at some point, say this state will try up to our fixed depth of two or three messages and find it's compatible with a single state here. So then we're done with state three, we're done with state zero. We move on to state one, try the commands, what's the minimal model we can build with, and continue. So this gives us a way of checking all of the messages with two major benefits. One, we don't have to brute force anything. And two, we know when we're finished up to our set depth. To apply this to real systems, Yuri implemented a very nice framework where there's a learner which implements the logic I just told you. And you can use this to test any protocol implementation you want. For an individual protocol implementation, you'll have a test harness. And this will translate just a label representation of the action to the real action. So the learner will say, send a client hello. The test harness translates this into a proper TLS message and sends it to the implementation. Implementation replies doing proper TLS. And the test harness will translate this into a single label back to the learner. So of course, there's some abstraction here, right? The test harness also needs to keep track of the nonces. The test harness also needs to be able to reset the system under test and handle errors, timeouts, that kind of thing. But given that, the runtime is around the depth you're testing to, the number of messages in your alphabet, to the power of the depth you're tested to for each state. So if you look at a core TLS implementation, we expect that to be around 16 minutes, depending on the complexity of the TLS implementation. So that's easily doable for this small examples. And I'll come back to that a bit later. Okay, so to see this actually running, rather than a live demo, I've done a video. And here I've got a toy protocol I've implemented. So we're not going to wait for 16 minutes. And it has a protocol with five different states. It's very simple. It takes static commands like int as the first message, which it replies to with an ACK. And there's an authentication message. And after the authentication message, it can do a data transfer. And we might have a simple security property here, such as we don't want data transfer to happen without the authentication mechanism. This is the configuration file for the learner, and we just tell it four messages which make up its input alphabet. And then we have a test harness, which will translate those messages and send them to the system under test. It will also implement a reset command to shut down and close up the system. And it will do a bit of error handling. If a connection is dropped, it changes that to a string to tell the learner connection dropped at this point. So to test this, we run the protocol. And then we'll run the test harness to act as an intermediary between the system under test and the learner. And then we run the learner itself. As this is a tiny protocol, it's terminated very quickly. And here you can see each of the queries it tried and the response it got from the learner. And you can actually see how it moved from the smaller queries first, building up to more complex queries until it managed to brute force to a level of 3 for each state. This also shows us the state machine. And this is the state machine it just learned. Do a bit of tidying up, but here you can see the logic of the program. An int is the only message that can be accepted first. Asking for data without authentication leads to an error. Authentication is acknowledged, and then you can request data. And just to be clear, this is absolute for that input language. This tells us that for that set of inputs and that implementation, these are the only actions which are possible. So in particular, we have a strong guarantee that for that input set, you cannot get the data without authentication, which gives me the kind of guarantees I would like to get from formal models, but actually for the implementation. Now, it's important to note I'm saying for that input set. Now, of course, with an implementation, there may be buffer overflows in here. There might be an input message I haven't tried, which will overflow a buffer and get to the data. But I do have a good, strong guarantee that for the input set defined, this is the behavior, and I can start to get security guarantees for real systems. Okay, so applying this to real TLS, there is a range of state machines. The first one is probably exactly what you'd expect. This is RSA's Java implementation of TLS. The first message it would accept, the client hello, key exchange change cipher spec. And of course, the message at the top is the input, the message below is what the server sends you in reply. And then application data is sent, and that all works perfectly. Now, this is what you'd model in a formal model. If I was modeling it in Tamarin, this is what I'd model, and that would be it. None of the other behaviors would be in there, they're not part of the spec. RSA simply goes to an error state for any other message. And in the error state, it doesn't accept any input. Now, this is what you'd probably expect when you implement the system. But in fact, this was the only implementation of TLS we've ever seen, which is this neat. Nothing else we've seen is like this. So this is GNU TLS. And as you can see, it's a bit of a mess. There are all kinds of error states. The green line is the correct one of the protocol. But there's another way you can follow it to the authentication state, which is even if it's not asked for it, the client can send an empty certificate. Now, in some versions of TLS, the server will request a certificate from the client, but normally that doesn't happen. In this implementation, even if it wasn't asked for, the client could send it and it wouldn't fail. So this other green line allows you to authenticate, but it's not a security issue. There's no way that can be exploited in any way. These other states, if you get into any of these other states, you can only end up in the failed state. So in fact, GNU TLS just handled failure quite badly. If it got one wrong message early, it would fatally die, but it wouldn't realize that it happened yet. And it would try to process following messages, and it would always end up closing the connection. So not very elegant, not a security risk. The Java implementation of TLS, however, was much more interesting. I'm not sure, I hope you can read this, but here's the green path which takes you to the exchange of application data. But this red dotted line also takes you to the exchange of application data. And this is an immediate red flag. If you've got a way to get to authenticated data exchange, without all the steps of authentication. So this is the client says hello, the client sends its nonce, and the client immediately says, now we're going to encrypt. So it's sent the message early. And what's happened here is, without going through all the steps, the server is told, we're exchanging encrypted data now, without going through the step of saying, let's encrypt. Now in the server, that let's encrypt step is when it generates its keys. So what's happening here is the server will start to encrypt data before it generates its key, and it will use whatever default memory it has in place in the key. So here it's tricked into encrypting with default memory rather than generating the fresh key. And this shows up very nicely in the state machine by this rogue path leading to the authenticated data set state. So we can immediately see something's going wrong. And it's turned out to be quite a major vulnerability against this implementation of TLS, which would easily let you break it. Showing up very nicely from the state machine. So as I said, that was mainly Yuri de Ritter's work. Work I did with Yuri as well and Chris. The first thing we did was extend this to WPA, the Wi-Fi protocol. And just to run through this, I won't go through it in detail, but just to run through it, there's an association and authentication step for the client and the access point to talk to each other. The access point will send the first message of the handshake E1 with a nonce and also some cipher suite information. Do they want to use SHA-2, SHA-1, MD5? And client replies with its nonce, a MAC, and the chosen cipher suite. The key is generated as a hash of the nonces and the Wi-Fi key. And if the next two messages check out, they confirm the cipher suite, they continue encrypted. So there are a number of issues of applying this state machine learning directly to WPA. The first one was the system under test only works if the system is completely deterministic. If you send a message one time and get one answer, and another time and another answer, it completely breaks that algorithm I just explained to you. And so that means lost packets and Wi-Fi interference will be handled very badly. So we handled that just by caching data. And when we saw conflicting results, the test harness would do effectively a majority vote and talk to and give the fixed decision to the learner. And this cache could also be used to look up answers. So if you'd already tried one query, you could look it up in the cache rather than retrying it. But that's all quite basic engineering. A more interesting question was dealing with timeouts. So WPA has a lot of behavior. It can behave in different ways when it times out. And those timeouts were too big to brute force. If we're talking about an exponential number of messages, if we make those 3-second delays as opposed to 20 millisecond messages, it simply becomes unfeasible. So to handle timeouts, we decided to make a number of assumptions about how the system works. So implicit in what I've said so far are a number of assumptions which limit this method somewhat. So these four assumptions are assumptions for all state machine learning. So it only applies to the known input messages. Can't be applied to black box systems where you don't know what the inputs and outputs are. And if you're missing inputs from your language, you get no security guarantees against the missing inputs. The system under test must be completely deterministic, no random behavior. And there's this set depth I mentioned where you can't go beyond it. And the state machine has to be finite. Otherwise, you'll learn nothing. So to these, we had another assumption that systems which time out only ever have one timer running at a time. And when we see retransmissions, we say that the retransmission will accept the same inputs and outputs as the state. And the retransmissions will be ended by a timer. So these are quite strong restrictions, but we found these work well, these are reflective of what we see implemented in actual protocols. We then learn the systems in two phases. The first phase is we learn it completely without time. And in the second phase, we'll go round the automata we've learned and add time. And we do that by adding effectively a second filter automata to the automata learning. Now what I'm saying here is I is my input alphabet. What I say is if I do an input, I continue as normal. And the theta here is a retransmission. Now the assumption here is retransmissions represent timeout behavior. So if I see a retransmission, I'll then go into a loop of delaying. Delta here is delay. So if I see a retransmission, I delay. And if I see another retransmission, I delay. Another retransmission and I delay. And then when I see a different action, that suggests some timeout state has been reached. And then I learn the timeout state. So effectively what I'm taking is the product of this automata and the automata I'm testing. Now, based on these assumptions, we could then effectively learn the systems with timeout. And the kind of things we saw are this. This was on Cisco routers. And here the green path is the correct authentication path. Again, that's what you'd model in a formal model. But we see some other behavior. We see if we have a time delay here, it rebroadcasts. And as assumed, if you send the correct message after rebroadcast, you get back on track. You get a second chance to time out and get back on track, and a third chance to time out and get back on track. But after a fourth delay, you get a deauthentication signal. So that's the state change after the timeout. We can now learn these actions. Coming around the other way, we can time out once, time out again, and now we have a different action. So we try to learn this state. And what we find in this state is we can send encrypted data, CECOM data. So this is sending encrypted data without the last message of the protocol. Now I can see why Cisco engineers implemented the protocol this way. The assumption is the message was just lost in transit, lost in transit, lost in transit. And now the router's receiving the message it would expect after the lost message. It could either tear down the entire protocol, which is what it should do, but I'm guessing the engineers sat there and said, hey, we've got the key ready to go. We have the data we're supposed to decrypt. Let's just decrypt it because the client must know the key. So that might seem to be secure when you first look at it, but this fourth message confirmed the cipher suite. So without this fourth message being processed, there was a simple downgrade attack. You could say, let's use MD5 as the hash here, skip the fourth message, and brute force the key. And this attack worked well. We showed it worked in practice. Cisco were very good about it, fixed it quite quickly. And this is an example of the kind of attack you'd never find in a formal model, because you wouldn't even think to try this and include it in your model. But this state machine learning can find this automata as an alternative model that shows it very clearly. So this was one attack. We found another attack against TP-Link routers, which didn't actually involve time here. It was a simple downgrade attack. Here we've got the green route saying, let's use SHA as our hash. And the green route goes all the way through using SHA-1 as the hash. But we also found that if you sent the messages using MD5 as the hash, they'd be accepted. So essentially, TP-Link routers would let you negotiate a strong crypto hash, and then halfway through, just suddenly start using a weak crypto hash and a simple downgrade attack. Unlike Cisco, TP-Link were pretty awful. They said it only applied to some of their older routers, so they had no intention of fixing it. So this actually went unpatched and probably took about 5 years. It would probably take a long time to actually get out of all of the systems, but there's not much you can do about that. So what I hope you get from this is, while these automata don't have the same expressiveness as a proper formal model in ProVerif or Tamarin, they do give a model of a real implementation which is expressive enough to find real vulnerabilities. So this part of the talk has been state machine learning is good, it's a useful technique to test real systems. However, there are some problems in what I've shown you. Now, one thing I mentioned is this depth limit. If you're only testing to two or three actions, that can be an issue. So this is the same protocol as I ran the demo on, but it's an alternative state machine, that protocol I showed you. So what I showed you before is it learned you had to do an int, then an authenticate, then you could send data. But it's possible it was an int, and then if you did 12 more ints, there's a secret backdoor, and you could authenticate that way. Now, remember I said I only tested to a depth of two. So the explanation would go down this far, and it would say, this looks consistent. I'm going to assume there's nothing here. So state machine learning, as I showed you, cannot find deep state. At one point, one of my co-authors was trying to put a deep state pun into our paper title, but that got taken out as the referees really didn't like it. And remember, it's exponential growth in the number of, in the depth you check, which makes it infeasible to check large depths. The other thing is, it's also exponential in the number of inputs. And actually, what I was showing you for TLS, 5, 6, maybe 8 inputs is kind of a maximum you can do. Whereas a full set of inputs for TLS would be more like 21. And looking at related work, most of the work in state machine learning has taken a small subset of inputs or reduced some of the complexity, meaning unrealistic input sizes and low depth. So we really wanted to do something about it, which was our most recent work. And while the L-star algorithm is really nice, we actually wanted to approach things in an entirely different, much more hacky way. So our newest approach to state machine learning is to run the system, send it the first message, and then snapshot the memory of the process. Send it the second message, snapshot the memory again, third message, and so on. Now we know these must be different protocol states. After processing each message, the protocol must go to a new protocol state. So we have three memory snapshots of three different states. And we'll do that again, and we'll do that again. And then what we do is a really big diff. So we'll look at state one and we'll do a diff and we'll find all the memory which is the same in that state in each run. So whenever we run the protocol, we see these bytes in these memory slots. And then we'll look at all of these bytes and we'll say which of these bytes don't appear in any other states. So here, these blue bytes also appear in state two. So we know these blue bytes can't be linked to being in state one, but the red bytes are unique to state one and appear in every state one. Therefore, we consider these candidate bytes to say we are in state one. And we repeat this for every state. And now we can tell what state we're in by a snapshot of a memory of a machine, and we don't have to do this brute force L-star algorithm. It makes it much more effective. We send a single message and we say, what state are we in now? Send every message, what state are we in now? We'll never send more messages than we need. So this gives us a learning procedure, where first we do some bootstrap queries. We do the correct run of the protocol, the happy run of the protocol, and then we trigger some standard error states to learn the error handling memory, which gives us our way to tell exactly what state we're in from snapshotting. Once we have that, we do a single run through the system for each path, checking the snapshots and generating the automata straight off, which gives us a very powerful way to do this. Of course, reality is much more complex than that. First problem is memory allocation is dynamic. Firstly, it's randomized. Secondly, malloc memory may occur anywhere on the heap. So what we end up with is, in fact, the memory differently distributed each time, and we need to align it. And what we actually do here is we use the same algorithms used on human genes to match up mixed up sequences of DNA, and we apply those to align the pieces of memory between each run. So that gets us around any randomness in how memory is allocated. And we were almost there, and this worked for about 90% of implementations. But the thing which absolutely killed us was counters in processes. So processes with something like a message counter can wrongly be identified as state memory in this method. So here, if we just count the messages, we might have a one here, a two here, a three here. That would look like state memory when it really wasn't. So we approach that by using some quite heavyweight symbolic execution. And for each bit of candidate state memory, we look at it and we say, does this candidate state memory affect the control flow?
Can I get you?
Was that a question? No. If you do have questions, please do stop me. So the memory which controls state must control the state, so it must affect writes to other state memory. So when we have some candidate state memory, we found by the stiffen method, we do a check, we'll take the code, and here, for instance, we have some control flow. Here we've got some state memory, which is being written to here. And we think, well, here, this call is checking the SSL certificate. And based on this call, it will update it or not. So that's clearly controlling the state. But here we have another candidate bit of state memory, which if it happens to be set to 12, such as that backdoor counter I showed you in the large automata, then it jumps to this state. So we'll look at this and we'll say, aha, this controls a jump, which controls state memory. Keep it in our candidate set of memory. If it's something like a counter, which doesn't control the flow of the program, we'll say it doesn't control the flow of the program, remove it from the state memory. So this is an extra check to make sure our candidate memory really does control state memory. So this means we can remove that assumption about a fixed depth. We can check machine, we can check the automata, and we can actually see we're making progress. Ooh, so actually, just quickly pop back to this example. So testing along this path here, we'll see the state memory, which controls that jump, changing each time. So we'll know it's worth continuing along this path. And we'll do that in linear time. We don't need to brute force anything. Which is great. And we also correctly identify state as we reach it. So we can actually make some progress on infinite state machines. Occasionally, you get protocols where there really is a counter which can count up arbitrarily and down arbitrarily. And here, with our method, we can now correctly approximate them for the number of steps we take. We do get a couple of assumptions, though. Our current method only works on heap memory. We could absolutely make it work on program counters or state stored on the stack, but we've never seen that. Real big protocol implementations we've never seen them actually store state by what part of the program you're in. And again, for a big bit of program, having state memory on the stack doesn't work either. We've also got this look ahead distance. How far do we look ahead to see if our state memory affects other state memory? And we look for 256 instructions. It could theoretically be more than that, but the compiler will not move things into registers a long time before they're used. So this, again, seems like a realistic assumption. So in our view, we've removed the brute force element. We've removed the test in depth, so we can now test much bigger libraries. So to give you, this is a sketch of our overall architecture then. We have the implementation, the system under test. We have the test harness I described, which will turn queries into real inputs and outputs. The learner, whose behavior is now much simpler, but the learner snapshots the system at each step. And where needed, uses this concolic analysis to say, is this bit of candidate memory actually used or not? So some experimental results. On the core alphabet, the tiny TLS alphabet used in other papers, we have significantly better performance. But when we take a full alphabet of 21 TLS signals, the black box method used by other methods usually just fails to terminate. Whereas our method can terminate between 1 and 4 hours. So this really does is let us use much more larger systems, much more detailed analysis. So some of the things we found, and a couple of Wi-Fi examples, again, one of which failed to terminate with black box, but terminated in an hour in our method. And this is the highly, highly simplified state machine of the one which failed to terminate. I don't know how well people know WPA as a protocol, or have you seen the crack attack recently? Matty, who found the crack attack, was one of our co-authors. So as soon as he saw this, there was a problem, which is this last message of the protocol, which sets the counter for the encryption key, can be arbitrarily repeated. So this meant in this particular Linux implementation of WPA, you could set the counter to be used in the counter mode encryption, and then you could set it again and again, and you could set it arbitrarily many times. Specifically, you could set it to the same thing, which in counter mode encryption means you can remove it. So this meant you could break the encryption using a variant of the crack attack on this WPA implementation. And we could look at that and say, wait a minute, that loop is not supposed to be there. That's clearly a mistake. You should not be able to send encrypted data after arbitrarily many different versions of the last step of the protocol. This was fixed actually very quickly and efficiently. So they removed the loop on the encryption state to fix it. But interestingly, their implementation added a couple of rogue states, which seemed to be error recovery for the first authentication accept. So they added some complicated error states. They made the state machine much more complex, but at the same time, they removed this loop here. So just by looking at the state machine, we could verify it was fixed. Another nice one, this one isn't simplified, but I realize this won't really be visible, but it gives you an idea of the kind of large states you can have. This green path, if you can make that out, is the correct run of the protocol. But there's these loops back, which take you back around the green path. So you can go down the green path and loop back and go down it again. And looking at these loops here, there was something very odd. So this was talking to the server. The client would send a client hello to the server. These red paths were a server message being sent to the server. What WolfSSL had done, which we learned later by talking to them, they used the same chunk of code for their client and their server implementation. It was one big switch statement, and it basically said, what's the message which is sent to you? Now we're going to process it. And they didn't distinguish between server and client messages in their implementation, which meant if you were a server, I could send you a client hello to set the client nonce, but I could also send you a server hello to set the server nonce. So the server would say, hello, this is my nonce. And if you sent it a message back saying, no, no, I'm the server, this is the server nonce, the server would say, okay, and it would reset its own nonce to the one you told it to set. So a very clear logical error. If you built that in a formal model, it would show up very nicely. But using the state machine learning method, you can analyze the implementation in a fully automatic way. And you get this model, this automata model out, which shows you these vulnerabilities. Okay, so that's pretty much all of my time. And again, my main points were there is some way to build some kinds of models from implementations. They're not as detailed, they don't have as much information as a full formal model, but they are correct up to the input set used, and they can reveal quite serious errors, which you wouldn't find by other analysis methods. If you're doing pure formal modeling, you probably wouldn't include these states. If you're doing fuzzing, none of this results in a crash, so it wouldn't show up in a fuzz test. Okay, so that's all I have to say, really. I hope some of you will consider this as a useful method if you've got to analyze systems. There are good libraries for all of this. If you want to try it out, please get in touch with me. Otherwise, that's it for me. And if you have any questions, please ask me now.
Okay, so any questions? Thank you, Tom, for a very clear talk otherwise. And I'm waiting to see if anyone would like to unmute themselves or ask in the chat. Paolo. Paolo raised his hand, but.
Yes, okay, thank you very much. Tom, was very, very interesting talk. I have a couple of questions. I was very interested. When you construct the state machine diagram, you have shown some expected behavior, like the green part and the red one. And how can you automatically determine the attack state, basically the red path? Is that any manual analysis or is fully automated?
Currently it's manual, which is a drawback. And now there are certain classes you could detect automatically. So if we just pop back to one of the earlier ones. So one absolute attack is if you ever have the correct path to the accepting state, if you have another path which gets you to that state, which skips some of the authentication stages, you know that's an attack. Okay. So if you can get to the encrypted exchange of data along a path which skips out an important step, that's definitely a vulnerability.
I was wondering if you have a formal model like a probability tamarin or FMC of the system under analysis, would you be able to identify states which constitute an attack automatically?
Actually, this is exactly what we're working on now. Can we combine this with formal modeling to get the best of both worlds.
Okay, thanks. And a second question, is there any prerequisite to run the tools, both the black box and the gray box, in terms of programming language? Would you support any arbitrary programming language?
Any language at all. The learner is a general purpose Java program which talks to a test harness over the socket. Now, you do have to write your own test harness for anything you want to test. So if there's a protocol you want to test, you've got to write your own test harness, which will translate messages from the learner into fully formed protocol messages. But once you have that, it can be applied to anything.
Okay, thanks. I think I'm going to look into, and maybe I will contact you for clarification. But thanks very much. It looks like an excellent work.
Thanks. Yes.
Great.
Okay. Any other questions? Let me scroll to see in the participants' view. Then I have a question. So. Right. Would there be a world in which to get the red lines that Paolo was discussing earlier, you could consider that you actually intersect two state machines? So a state machine of the specification that should be sort of the correct behavior, and a state machine that is state machine of an implementation. And when you overimpose them, superimpose them, or intersect them somehow, if you see this, for example, unusual loops in the implementation, that should indicate that there's something untoward in the implementation that doesn't follow the specification, and therefore that is potentially a red line or an attack line. Is there something like this used?
No. I mean, so the question is that possible? Mm. That's a very interesting question. Now, but the question is, what is the specification? So this is GNU TLS.
Mm.
And this is perfectly secure.
Yes.
But it does have this weird other path where it sends an empty certificate.
Yeah.
And all these odd error states. So if you took something like this as your specification of TLS, and intersected it with this, you'd get loads of false negatives.
Correct.
So false positives.
Yeah, false positives.
Mm-hmm. So to answer your question, a attack would show up this way, but you'd also get a lot of false positives at the same time.
Yeah, I guess that if one did this superposition, then they would need to refine and define the superposition quite well to check and prune some of these false positives, because indeed you might have extra states, for example, that are perfectly valid in the implementation, but where they're not extra states and they're weird arrows in the graph, then maybe there's a call for not a false positive, but in fact an actual red line. But yeah, interesting thought.
Right. There might be some clever way to classify these states which would distinguish the real attacks from the false positives.
Okay. I have more questions, but I'll stop for a second in case there are other questions. I don't want to monopolize the conversation. Okay. Right. So which would you say, so I'll ask my next question, which would you say by far that was the most complex implementation that you looked at that caused you to improve this the furthest, to improve the technique, to maybe look beyond into the newer work that you've done after the work of Yuri? And why is that? I mean, what was it that it was, you said counters, but beyond counters, what was it in this, you know, a little bit of hidden states and so on, but which was the one that showed most problems that really pushed you to move forward and improve Yuri's work?
I'm I'm trying to remember which ones it was. I think it was this RSA one. So not to criticize Yuri, who's not here, but he actually had a quirk in his test harness on how he handled nonces.
Mm.
And that actually meant he learnt the wrong state machine for this one.
I see.
Because what he was learning was the interaction between the state machine, and his test harness was sending the incorrect message and saying, oh, the system under test has faulted. But in fact, it was absolutely fine. And that was part of the reason why we wanted to be able to look inside that system. So if our test harness sends the wrong message, our memory snapshot will say, no, the system's in a correct state. It's you who have a problem.
Mm.
It was also, the big driver for us was looking at these core messages, and we wanted to find more attacks. So we said, let's do the client certificate processing as well.
Mm-hmm.
And we wanted to add client certificate processing. And just adding the client certificate messages to past work was enough to break it. So one real driver of this work was having a full TLS test message, because other people had found vulnerabilities. We wanted to find more vulnerabilities. We thought full TLS was the best way to do that.